911, somebody come get this bitch. Nigga, you a star on the ride, you got time to reply. Don't lie, you can eat my shit. You can leave me five little nigga on the side, little nigga cooked out, need to fix my whip. I switch sides with a nigga who's down, your nigga, you're a fraud, just fit my nigga, my whip. Oh, you know I never did you wrong. Even though I'm right here by the phone, dog. You know you never used to call. Keep it that way now. I'll treat you like a dead right now. I'm on your head right now. You wanna fuck with me so bad right now. But now you care right now. Oh,
2018, I was in my sister's house the whole summer. Songs wasn't doing numbers. Whole life was going under. Left school, then my dad and I had face in Atlanta. He said it's one me and me and Chance, and I told him, Daddy, I ain't never wanna. I ain't never need no nigga. I ain't never need no feature. If I didn't blow, I would've died, you'd be here. If it didn't go to my side, I wouldn't be here. Now they all come around, let it be here. You get this rich and famous, everybody come up to you singing. Hallelujah, how you doing? You've been on my mind, you've been running through, yeah. Hallelujah, hallelujah. You've been on my mind, you've been running through, yeah. You know I never did you wrong. Even though I'm right by the phone, dog. You know you never used to call. Keep it that way now. I treat you like a dead right now. I'm on your head right now. You wanna fuck with me so bad right now. But now you care right now. Mama told me she was gonna stop fucking around with that nigga. Told me she was playing, but I'm knowing that I had to deceive her. My mama told me that she loved me, don't believe her. When she get drunk, she hit me up out with a fever like, oh, you ain't even know that pretty. Ain't even now that nigga. He ain't even now when God will forgive you. Shit. He ain't even now that pretty. He ain't even now that nigga. He ain't even now when God will forgive you.
You know I never did you wrong. Even though I'm right here by the phone, dog. You know you never used to call. Keep it that way now. Treat you like a dead right now. I'm on your head right now. You wanna fuck with me so bad right now. But now you care right now. Oh,
treat you like a dead right now. I'm on your head right now. You wanna fuck with me so bad. Grand Rising, Conscious Crew, Grand Rising, TGIF. Hope you guys are doing well. I am up as always. My day start very early. We'll get into all of that. But you already see the title, so we got a few things to get into. I'm not going to keep you guys long. I just want to kind of come and give a little 1-2-1-2 before I push on through. Before we do so, go ahead and thumbs up this video until it is absolutely stuck. You guys know to thumb it up the video. Not only helps with YouTube's algorithm, but more importantly, it triggers up YouTube's notification system. So when you are literally when you are literally thumbing up the video, you are literally knocking on the digital door of another Conscious Crew member and telling them to get their arses into the sanctuary, because the king is in fact kanging. Also, shout out to all other new subbies. Make sure that you guys have your notification bell set to all. And last but not least, please share the stream out to whatever it is you have digital community, whether that be your YouTube community wall, your MySpace, your Instagram, your Snapchat, BGC, the dark side of Twitter, Tumblr, or your personal OF. I don't really give a damn where you lay the link. Just let them whores know that we're allowed live and in color. With no further ado, let's go ahead and push on through. Oh, cool.
I know a place where you can recharge your soul.
Baby, that's Conscious TV.
And in the midst of brokenness, he gon' see your asshole.
Baby, that's Conscious TV.
You gon' heal, you gon' laugh, and catch a little shade.
Ooh, girl.
Y'all know he be slaying, y'all better stop playing. Come hear what he's saying.
Ladies and gentlemen,
Let me go ahead and speak to the fam before we get into the things. What's going on, Emily? Hey, Queen B. Moore. What's going on, Azor? What's going on, Cheryl? Hey, Cynthia. What's going on, Neo? Hey, what's going on, Tanya? Hey, y'all. Grand Rising. I know this is early. It's improv. But I was like, you know what? Let me just get up here because I'm just in one of those moods. So my days start off really, 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 really early because I get up and I do my morning meditations, which usually last anywhere between 30 minutes to an hour. I get up and do a total energy cleansing, get into some transcendental meditation, really clear my vessel and invite all of the beautiful cosmic forces of the universe to just pour into me and make myself just a throne for that type of power and principle, you know, all things light and love in the multiverse. Then I get up and do my workout, which is usually like 30 minutes to 45 minutes where I cycle. I have a lot of heels on the property that I'm on. So I be cycling my ass off, you know, just keeping everything flat and tight and right. And, you know, just being a bad bitch. Then, you know, my day unfolds. So after I get done working out, which I just came out of a meditation, I got up really, really, really early today because I got some things I want to get out of the way before I get into my day. I got to go wash like 3 loads of damn clothes. I just got like some miscellaneous stuff to do before I get into the business of today. So while I was getting things situated and getting myself together, I was up in her. What's going on? I am Nicole watching Lil Nas X documentary. So I've been hearing about a lot of different documentaries that have been hitting the airwaves. I know the Freaknik documentary done came out. So I will be watching that probably today. We're probably coming back tomorrow, maybe even tonight, possibly, and talking about all y'all mammies, including mine, busting it wide open for Kanye West when he was just a regular nigga. Okay, down there at the Freaknik in 1995. So, you know, we're going to be getting into that. I also kept hearing about this Quiet on the Set documentary, which unpacks the diabolical exploitation of children who worked up under Miss Nickelodeon. Girl, I was shook, okay? I kept seeing the Quiet on the Set headlines in my algorithm, but I did not know what the hell it was. Until earlier today, I was watching some things and someone that I watch on YouTube was actually covering it. And I was like, ooh, okay, let me check that out, girl. And they done, it's an 8-episode documentary and they're already on part 3, girl. I am shook. That just 1 through 3 episode literally left me feeling so weird and bizarre. My mouth was on the floor. I was not surprised, but nonetheless shocked. I'm always going to be shocked when it comes to the destruction and the literal targeting of the innocent. And in this case, children. I thought that Disney's expose would come before Nickelodeon. You know, we have always heard about the undertones of sexuality and occultism hidden in Disney's cartoons and imagery and symbolisms and the sexual innuendos of it all. And, you know, we also have things that have came out as it relates to Disneyland, Disney World. It's been a whole mess. But girl, if Nickelodeon was an 8-part series, then I can only imagine that Miss Disney's expose is going to be like 1 through 100 damn episodes, because I had no idea that Nickelodeon had it even going on like this. Like, literally, I don't recall ever hearing anything about Nickelodeon like that. Once again, like, Disney controversy really took up a lot of that space, but I am literally floored. Like, I had to go damn fast after I watched 1 through three. And I don't even know where this docuseries is going because it's 8 parts. And I'm just like, girl, what more is there? Girl, you telling me there's more? Like, there's more. Like, there's 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Girl, that's 5 more parts? I don't even know if I'm going to make it. Okay? And I don't even know how to review something like this. There are so many moving parts as it relates to power dynamics between children and adults, employees and employers, pedophilia. It's just so fucking much to unpack. And I'm just like, do I want to review this? Because it's noteworthy of a conversation and bringing awareness, especially to the casting couch of Hollywood that unfortunately doesn't just consist of adults being exploited, but minors as well, exploited to the utmost. And But every time I think about how I would review it, girl, or where I would even get started in a conversation, my brain just freezes and just glitches. But if you guys haven't seen it, watch it. I watch it on this bootleg site that Reckless Logic put me on to a few months ago. And I may review it once it comes to completion. I don't know. It's just a lot going on. But I was then started watching Lil Nas X documentary, girl. And I'm not even finished with this documentary, girl. I don't, how much more left on Miss Lil Nas X? Hold on. Let me see how much more I got left, girl. I'm at 56 minutes. All right, so I got about 40 more minutes of Miss Nas X. And I'm probably going to sound like a hater, but I'm also okay with being a hater at this point. Hold on, y'all. I have transcended all of that, girl. I just say what the hell I need to say. And I don't really be giving a damn about how it's perceived or how I'm perceived, girl. I'm a commentator. This is what I do for a living. And this is what the fuck I'm going to do until I transition into the entirety of the goddamn glory, girl. Miss Lil Nas X. I don't know if you guys heard about it. I didn't even know this documentary was even coming, girl. To be honest, I kind of have been living under a rock the past few weeks. I have not really been present in pop culture like that. So I feel like I'm kind of playing catch up a little bit. The past like 5-6 weeks for me have been really dedicated to doing like a lot of shadow work. And I know that we have like a very crazy retrograde that is coming. And Miss April, girl, this is supposed to be another table shaking retrograde. And I know that it's going to be epic as fuck. And I'm just already preparing myself. I know that there's going to be some very ugly truths that are going to be revealed, if not publicly, definitely personally. I already know kind of, I think I'm going to be really tested, or a test is going to present itself during this retrograde. And I think I know where the tests are going to be, because, you know, anything that's raggedy in your life is going to pretty much come under subjection, you know, under a retrograde. So I've been kind of already like just clearing myself and just kind of getting ahead of the damn universe by going into myself, situating myself, having really hard conversations with myself. Coming to terms, coming to face with some realizations and some truths that are true entirely are true right now. Okay. And just doing the hard work, because girl, I do not want this retrograde to Jerry Springer me. And I just am not ready for a crazy retrograde for myself. I don't mind the world being turned upside down, but I just want this retrograde for me to be as smooth as possible. And I'm not going to wait on retrograde to come and clean my house. I'm going to go ahead and, you know, get into my own inventory and situate it before the boss comes through with an evaluation, if you know what I mean, okay? So the past few weeks, you know, I've just kind of been in my spirit and in my inner man and just getting, you know, just cleaning up any gunk, just doing some internal house cleaning and all of that. So I kind of pulled back a little bit and just got focused and just, you know, dived in. So I'm finally kind of like bobbing back to the surface and I feel pretty good. I came back to the surface with a middle part. I retired my side swoop. And it's so funny at going back to a middle part dynamic because my side swoop era was just like really interesting. And I don't even really know what the side swoop thing was about, aside from the fact that, I mean, on a very superficial level, I was just ready to kind of like just do something different with my hair. I had already done every type of side part, middle part. I had did all of that shit. I wanted something more edgy, more G.I. Jane, more G.I. Joe, something more spicy and different. So like shaving a third of my hair the fuck off and putting parts and designs in it and walking around looking like a drug addict was like a really glamorous one. I was listening to this girl because, you know, like before I had decided to cut a third of my hair off to accommodate my side shave, I was looking up people who had already did a third of the cut and was kind of seeing how they felt about having to commit to it. Because obviously, like, cutting off your natural hair is not a... like, it's something you're going to have to live with if you're going to do it because, you like, your hair isn't going to grow back overnight. So, you know, all that hair you chop off, you're going to have to, like, really commit to the style, whatever that style is, because it's going to take time to grow back. And for me to get my hair back off the ground from the scalp, girl, to even out with the rest, well, first of all, my own natural hair is, like, 19, 20 inches. So it'll take me a few years to grow the portion of my hair that I shaved off, which I'm still not interested in growing that hair out. I'm still keeping my side shave now that I know how to wear a middle part, even with that hair missing on the side. But I was listening and watching this girl and she was just like, yeah, like, the side shave is really cool because she had did it and her hair looked pretty dope. And she was just talking about like how she get weird stares in public and some of the misconceptions that people have. She was like, people are going to think you're into drugs. And I was hollering when she said that people think she does drugs because of her side shave, girl. So for some reason, like, once I had decided I was going to do a side shave style, I was just like, I called it the drug addict hairstyle because it was just such a gag. But kind of undergoing the past 6 weeks of shadow work, I could tell something like really happened to me. Going that far into myself, because I literally once again came back up and out with a whole new hairstyle. Okay, that's how I know some shit. Like, that's how I know I be hitting on some shit, because, you know, energy is vibration and vibrations are assigned to their corresponding frequencies. So, you know, feelings are attached to colors. Colors are attached to numbers. You know, it's all an interconnected matrix. So you know, my side shave era was about one type of energy and a certain type of consciousness and psychology and attitude, which was just like this rad ass, I don't give a fuck, rebellious kind of anti-society, but yet pro-society, kind of like anti-conservativeness, pro-liberal, pro-futuristic, you know, very progressive attitude, et cetera. And my hair was a reflection of that progressiveness. It was also a symbol of my self-acceptance and my willingness to like show up as different as I am, as creative as I am, without no shame in my game, being able to like own who the fuck I am. And being able to just stand in that under any circumstance. And then the shadow work happened. And I don't know, I came back up looking like Jesus. So I guess I tapped into some cosmic consciousness. And we'll kind of get into that a little bit later in this commentary. What's going on, So Deb? Good morning, Grand Rising, So Deb. Make sure y'all subscribe to my boy, So Deb. He's an amazing content creator. What's going on, Jackie? Grand Rising Sin, Grand Rising Divine On. Hey, Bill. Grand Rising C. Johnson. Hey, how you all? So back to Lil Nas X. So Lil Nas X just sucks. You guys know I have not been a fan of Lil Nas X ever since somebody decided to manufacture a career for him. And I really tried to allow the system to make Fetch like actually work, like to make Fetch happen. And so I've just kind of been sitting on the edge of my seat on, you know, waiting for the moment where I can get it, you know, where I can finally just be like, yes, Lil Nas X is dope. He's sickening. It just has not happened, girl. And it's been, what, 2-3 years now? And he done been to hell. He done been to heaven. Now he Jesus and down on the cross. And it's just not there for me. And I thought that maybe watching this documentary was going to unravel something about the Lil Nas X phenomenon that, you know, maybe I just been too tardy to the party to receive, to know. And girl, it's giving all of nothing. It's giving all of nothing. Like, Lil Nas X is a total gimmick. And in being fair, what I will give him is I think he's a talented musician and writer. Like, I think he could have had a very successful career being a producer, being a ghostwriter, writing for other artists, seems to be more so his lane. But being the actual front and center star, Lil Nas X has not convinced me. On no fucking level. Like, there's no it factor. There's no stage presence. There's no nothing. Like, he looks so uncomfortably successful. Like, Lil Nas X is literally the definition of an industry plant. I'm not going to say that Lil Nas X is a part of some big conspiracy to turn the world gay and to turn black men gay, but obviously a larger system decided that they could capitalize off of an inclusive era where queer representation was something that was that the public was hungry for, that queer people and their allies were hungry for. And between the Caitlyn Jenner era and just trans visibility and queer rights and same-sex marriage being legalized, and, you know, so obviously capitalism attached itself to all of that. And then everybody wanted to get on an inclusive wave. And everybody wanted, you know, to target, you know, this particular demographic. And the music industry was no different. You know, it's capitalistic like any other system. It's interested in making money. And it's opportunistic. And if it sees an opportunity to make some fucking money, if it sees or feels that it can bank off of a thing, off of a trend, off of whatever it is, then the industry will. And in that, Lil Nas X happened. And Lil Nas X and the powers that be found themselves, you know, in an ideal situation, and it worked. One more positive I would give him is between Caitlyn Jenner shocking the world with her transition, and then Lil Nas X being a dark-skinned, queer black male who did not mind flamboyancy and femininity, and representing that, I appreciate, like, the demolition it caused. It gave birth to the type of conversations that have been long overdue in the black community as it relates to queerness in general, homophobia, and I could appreciate his controversy and his trolling in that way because of what opportunity it gave to the collective. But even with that being said, even with such a great opportunity to deal with some of the demons and devils that are in the underbelly of the black community, such as transphobia and homophobia and queerphobia, Lil Nas X, the messenger, I just wish, and beggars can't be choosers, girl, right? Because when there's lack, girl, you gotta take what you can take. But I also feel like a part of why Lil Nas X caught a lot of heat and caught a lot of slack, and there was a lot of pushback against him, wasn't just due to homophobia. It was also due to something that was heavily, 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 heavily manufactured. And I felt like that complicated the type of conversations that would have had a better opportunity at being had if there wasn't a agenda here. Now, once again, I'm not going to say the Lil Nas X and the powers that be agenda was to make the world queer, because queerness just, it doesn't work like that. That's just not how sexuality works. But it was opportunistic and it was capitalistically driven. And because of that, it was very inauthentic, and that created something very off-putting, even in the mouths of some of us in the queer community, like myself, who want to see the inclusivity of it all. But also want that authenticity and want the seriousness there, because we're talking about, anytime we're talking about any minority group, whether it's black men, black women, trans women, black queer people, we're talking about some serious shit. And we're talking about groups that are really suffering emotionally, spiritually, societally, economically, politically. And I don't take that shit. With any less of an energy than seriousness. I don't take those issues light. And I didn't appreciate queerness being a trend. I didn't appreciate queerness being reduced to just a shock jock variable to generate money. I didn't appreciate just how dehumanizing it was, which is the general problem with things being politicized, especially in entertainment, is that it really cheapens the movements a lot, whether it's feminism, LGBT pro rights, I mean, Black Lives Matter, you name it. And it's a double-edged sword because spaces like Hollywood and the industry are just vehicles for messages. And music has always been used, like the industry has always been used to perpetuate, propagate certain things that were happening amongst the people, you know, music for the people, you know, do it for the culture, etc. But I just feel like this era is just getting really terrible at just making it look so cheap. Like, it's already bad enough that it's only capitalism that's even driving the industry to even prop up representation to begin with. But then to kind of like be bold about it and to not even like try, you know, to not even try to conceal the parts that should be covered by the curtains, you know, it's just too much and it's annoying. And with that being said, I have just not been able to get into Lil Nas X. I feel like I'm watching a 14-year-old white female TikToker perform on stage when I'm watching Lil Nas X. He's so immature and he's so short-sighted. He lacks total fucking substance. And I hate that he doesn't know any better either, or maybe does know better and just don't give a fuck. As to always relying on a gimmick, which also tells me that he clearly must be deeply insecure and know exactly what I know, which was that he's not and does not possess the whole I and the whole T. He got the I, but he ain't got the T. Or he got the T, but he ain't got the damn I. And he clearly knows that, which is why he always needs the extra stank to put on a project in order for it to be recognized and for it to be a moment. Watching this documentary, which focuses a lot on his first tour and the days leading up and the rehearsals leading up, girl, and I'm watching the end result of like 22 weeks of rehearsal because they apparently had to put this all together in a month. They had to put the set together. They had to put the choreography together. They had to put it all together in 4 weeks, girl, and everything else is up to par. The dancers are up to par. Lil Nas X is just, girl, I couldn't tell the difference between the rehearsals and the finished product. I just couldn't do it, girl. I thought it was a rehearsal for the rehearsals. And I don't want to sound like a hater either because, like, Lil Nas X deserves whatever it is that he is putting his time and energy in, girl, but I just, I just can't do it, girl. It's just Lil Nas, just, this just ain't it. This ain't it. And Lil Nas X doesn't even have the range to really like change the game in a substantive way, because you would think that someone being propped up as the so-called queer artist, if this was genuine on his behalf and it was genuine on his team's behalf, then why hasn't this man yet to create space for the representation of other queer artists? Because there are so many amazing same gender loving and trans, non-binary artists, but yet he's working with Jack Harlow. You know, I think him and Saucy Santana did a joint together, girl, but that was also short-lived. It didn't even come with a music video, and there was really no buzz about it. And you know, it's just like, what are you really doing? I don't know what. I feel like Lil Nas X time is dwindling, girl. Like, his clock is ticking, and in the words of New York, it's clicking down, boots. Okay? He got a lot of clapback as it relates to this whole Jesus single and shit. Like, it's tired, it's old, it's now predictable. People know that you're just gonna do something polarizing, and it's wearing off. Which is a good thing, because if there is any other talent left and any degree of substance in there, girl, then this is what's going to push that shit up and out. And I don't think there's going to be an up and out, because I just don't think that it's even in there to begin with. The part that I paused on when it came to the documentary is Lil Nas X and his family. His dad, his brothers, they all came on tour with him. I think his mom also pulled up, and he was just talking about how he now feels comfortable and he can be himself around them, and he feel like he can kind of just like do anything now without feeling self-conscious. And the brothers are ghetto in their durags, like, yeah, the Montario tour, blah, 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 blah. And you know, the dad is allegedly like proud and is willing to go to a gay club with him. And he's in the documentary like, yeah, I just always wanted to like change the mentality of my family about things. And it's like, even that is so fucking performative. And I don't understand how Lil Nas X at least doesn't like confront that when it comes to his people. Because obviously, his ghetto ass family is only willing to endure all the gay shit because it comes with this hyper visibility and this hyper success and this hyper wealth. And who the fuck is going to be stupid enough to miss out on their meal ticket? Okay, like, duh, anybody's going to put aside their fucking homophobia. You know, anybody's going to put aside their bigotry if that bigotry can get in the way of a bag, can get in the way of fame, can get in the way of access and visibility. And it seems that he's coming from an atypical, indignant ass, homophobic, struggling family. So it's a come up for them all. Perfectly fine. But once again, this is where the documentary like lacks luster at. And this was an opportunity to kind of like deepen this homophobia that apparently has been pervasive in his lived experience by confronting that, like confronting his parents, confronting his siblings, and really getting them to do some self-analyzing as it relates to, like, have y'all considered if you guys are okay with me being openly gay because of what it led to and who I now am to the world. Like, because obviously none of this acceptance and embrace was on the floor when I was poor, when I was going from pillar to post, and I didn't have a relationship to my dad, who's now in the fucking picture. And, you know, y'all wouldn't have been going to a gay club with me in 2011, in 2012, in 2015. But because I'm that nigga now, you know, what has happened? And I just think it would have been great to put them in that position to deal with themselves, like, give them, set them up to do the work, to go into themselves, to kind of go deeper than the surface, which is the clout, the fame, the money, etc. And I would have loved to see him kind of wrestle through that as a perspective as well, because, I mean, I don't know whether he's too scared to really have them do that work, because he may want to live in a fantasy of just, hey, I'm just happy that they made it. I don't give a damn if they had to accept me by way of money, fame, fortune, if those were the things that drove them to create a space for me where I can so-called feel safe in, then so be it. But, you know, as somebody who really likes to do their work and likes to really see other people do their work, the surface shit for me is just not enough. And I feel like you can fool a lot of people, but you can't fool the universe. And what we pretend to be only continues to show up in other ways in our lives. And if not in this life, it damn sure bleeds over into the next incarnation. There is no running from your work. There is no escaping your work. You're bound to it like the gravitational pull of a fucking rubber band. And so it just comes down to, like, how long can you endure being brought back to the same homework in one incarnation after another incarnation, from one situation to another situation in the same incarnation. So breaking all that karmic debt and all that shit up is healthy for us, and it brings us to our full selves. And the issue with performative acceptance of queer people is it makes people like Lil Nas X a token. And what oftentimes happens when queer people are being accepted because they've earned the acceptance rather than that acceptance be extended to them, because that's just a dignified, humane thing to extend to any other fucking human being, is you end up as the token, and those same people who are accepting you do not accept anybody else who is queer, because once again, those other queer people have not earned anybody else's respect. So you may have cleared up the homophobia in front of you, but those same secret homophobes that are wrapping their arms around you are still dropping F-bombs on some queer person who is minding their business in the club, at the bar, by those same fake-ass relatives and bros. Because to imagine his brothers now wrapping their entire arms around all queer people would be a damn stretch. And to imagine his dad wanting to sit in a queer space, like a gay club, on his own fruition, we also know would be a damn stretch. And I have experienced tokenism in my own family, where my relatives accept me while still holding anti-queer politics and attitudes toward LGBT people in general, or LGBT people outside of the tribe, outside of the circle. That's why we always push up against the people who say, well, I have a lesbian best friend, or a trans best friend, or a gay best friend, or I have a black friend, because we know that tokenism is a real thing. And we know that just because you accept a minority person does not mean or tell us anything about what your politics truly are about that group as a whole. Once again, I just think that these would have been interesting tidbits for the documentary to kind of push and to kind of like, you know, like push up against. It would have brought some substance to Lil Nas X, because right now everything is just given very Taylor Swift, girl. It's given just very surface level, very generic, very mediocre. What's going on, goalie? Hey. What's going on, Grand Rising? We here talking about Lil Nas X right now, and just how I just cannot do this generic representation. It's just fucking annoying to me. I'm just not a Lil Nas X. Divine Eye says, baby, you speak in a tongue he don't know, let alone. And that's another thing too, like, maybe Lil Nas is young, so I'm just like, girl, maybe, you know, I mean, maybe in a few years, girl, he will come up and out, you know, maybe. So I don't know, but it's not given. Disappointed in the documentary, just like I'm disappointed in his career. I'm disappointed in his performances. Girl, who needs to be the goddamn superstars, all those goddamn backup dancers, girl, who be working hard for the money. So hard for the money. Like, if it wasn't for all that shit, if it wasn't for those damn 80 million motherfucking, like, dancers in the background, Lil Nas X would be bankrupt right now, because Lil Nas X is not main character energy at all. Like, he may look like the real thing, but it's very much so a bootleg, and you just gotta look a little bit closer, baby, to see that, you know, them big wheels, you know, only keeping on turning because other motherfuckers are turning them, okay? So, I don't know. Lil Nas X, hold on, let me be careful, because I don't want to say real queer people, but I'm waiting for the queer, for the group of queer artists who are really there and who really got it, who really understand the assignment, to kind of enter the group chat. Like, I'm waiting on them. And that's how I know, once again, that this is a fad and a trend, and it's not even like a total and a entire trend, because why is Lil Nas X still the only girl out of us all? Which is why I'm also, once again, still disappointed in him, because he's in a position to really usher in, you know, which has been my criticism for Nicki Minaj, you know, who had over a decade to usher in other women in a space that they were not dominating. And Lil Nas X is sitting in the same predicament. And I just don't understand people who have this, I want to be the only one attitude. I'm such a communal ass bitch. I'm such a communal ass person. I'm such a us ass person that it's very hard for me to understand people who don't mind just taking up all the space all by themselves. I don't even know why any person would just want to be the only motherfucker in any given situation. Like, I would want to replicate a dozen other stars. I would want to replicate a dozen other et ceteras, whatever it is. So I'm just like, girl, I could go on and on and on. I'm just going to leave it at the documentary is hitting all or nothing. Cuz has facts. No disrespect. Support Nephew Nas, but the community is so stereotyped. The rep rainbow for diversity. And why is he allowing that to be the case? Because Lil Nas X is obsessed with himself, just like Cardi B. His ass be in those algorithms. His ass watch content about himself. His ass see the conversations about him. And for him not to, like, take the meat at all and spit out the bone is just, once again, more disappointing factors, because he hears these conversations. He knows what is given. He knows what he ain't given. And I'm just waiting for Lil Nas X to really take it there. I think that Lil Nas X assignment was to be a bulldozer and to blow the wall down, to tear down the fourth wall. And then from there, girl, it's supposed to be everybody else that runs through that opening. And that just hasn't happened yet. And it doesn't seem like he's going to escalate the visibility of his own community as somebody who feels that there should be representation of people like him in the space. So I guess he's getting his Nicki Minaj on. But let's move on to other things, girl. So going back to the shadow work that I was talking about earlier. I got really depressed probably about, 2 months ago, maybe? And I realized it was because, I realize now as a result of 6 weeks of shadow work that what I do is like what most human beings do. Like, we believe in ourselves, yes, but we also like to believe in things outside of ourselves, especially because we know that belief in ourselves is going to dwindle. You know, holding on to the divine mind is a fleeting one. You know, it's something that can't be totally consistently held on to. It's like wind. And this space that we're in as a society, technology, social media, is given very much so zombie apocalypse. I am not comfortable in this era. I don't like this version of society. I don't like this version of the collective at all. And it has become more difficult to find things and find people outside of yourself that you can truly believe in and, you know, see your hopes and see your self and see your highest self in. So I found myself not having anywhere to go externally, like, and I mean like psychically, like not having anywhere to go emotionally or mentally when I fell into like, you know, the sadness or this distress, you know, because as a fucking empath, like, it's just a lot, you know, to deal with the way the world is right now. And I have been pretty vocal about, like, this era really being a very difficult era for me personally. I have not enjoyed technology. I do not enjoy social media. I just don't enjoy it. I just don't like this era. I just don't like it. You know, I just cannot stand anything about it. You know? So for me, you know, it has been challenging spiritually. This very technological world, this very non-sentient, this very AI chat, GPT-EFG-ass era, this clicking views, this it's just, girl, the messaging and the art now, like all the music, you know, especially in our culture and community, you know, if you loved hip hop, if you love pop music, it's just like, I don't know. All the messaging is about chasing the bag and chasing everything but the inner substance of it all, chasing everything but love. It's actually very anti-love. It's very anti-people. It's fuck people and it's money over people and it's all this shit, girl, that just contradicts, you know, my priorities and that just slaps everything that I stand for and everything that I want to experience and everything that I believe in the fucking face. So trying to cope and find my way through the straw, you know, for the needles, metaphorically speaking, has been interesting. And I've noticed that, like, when I've gotten into that place of sadness and feeling, like, really disconnected from the times, that it was harder for me to recalibrate and kind of get myself out of the sunken place, because I also did not have, like, any external forces to pull from. I didn't have any leader. I didn't have anything to pull from. You know, like, which made everything even more bleak, because you guys know that I've also I'm having another experience of my Christian faith. I started off as an atypical Christian, and then I evolved into a Christian mystic. And, you know, through continual study, because, you know, I always have my head to the books academically as it relates to spirituality, as it relates to religion, etc. These are very important areas of my life. I've been taking in a lot of information and academia around the historical Jesus and just Christianity, and coming to the reality that Christianity is not literal. It's not necessarily literal history, and the historical Jesus is very different from the fan fiction Jesus that exists as the biblical Jesus. And that wasn't really a difficult thing for me to accept, because for me, I always related to Christianity from a philosophical perspective. So I did not mind if the biblical characters were not historical people, or if they were historical people, they were very different people than the way they were narrated, you know, and assimilated to, you know, for the purpose of a religious institution. But as a result of me giving up the literalism of it all, it has put me in this place where I realized that if I'm going to give up the spiritual deities and figures that at one point in my life I accepted as literal figures, that the only tangible truth and the only tangible God that I am going to ever be able to know in this body as a biological being is myself, which is where I am now. As a result of me now kind of giving up looking for, because I always focus on God inwardly anyway, but of course there was a percentage of me that was also interested in God outside of me. But I've kind of closed that gap entirely now. And I have accepted that the only God I'm going to know is the one that's in me. That has now brought me better peace, because the part of me that wanted something to believe in outside of myself, the part of me that wanted people to believe in outside of myself has now died. And I realized that it's up to me to be the truth as I know it to be. Hold on, y'all. And I'm actually excited about that because it makes it my job to be the love I want to see in the world, to be the light I want to see in the world, to be the integrity, to be the virtue that I want to see in the world. And now that I'm not expecting some leader outside of myself to enforce that or to inspire that, now that I'm not expecting any savior to come back for me, now that I have accepted that it's all on me to be the living truth, I feel liberated. And I feel like it's taken a burden off of me because now I only have to worry about and focus upon personifying the consciousness in myself. It took me a long time, y'all, to accept that everybody is not like me. And people used to tell me this my whole life. CTV, you cannot expect other people to be like you. You can't expect them to think like you. You can't expect them to move like you move. You can't expect them that. And I just be like, fuck all that, fuck all that, fuck all that, fuck all that. But now I know why they were telling me that, because it's not that you can't expect it, but when you are really invested in having other people also like show up, it can chip away at the quality of your own lived experience. And I don't want that chipping away. I don't want to be focused on rather other people are keeping it all together. I need to focus on me keeping it together, me maintaining the truth as I know it to be, me showing up as the person that I am and the person that I strive to be. And that's my first and foremost priority, is making sure that I'm long as I'm moving in the way that I believe is the proper way to go. Long as I'm like getting the A, you know, that's the only thing that I can ultimately control. That's the thing that's in my control. And with so many people kind of like falling away from the principal system, falling away from the honor code, falling away from character and integrity, these things seem to be going extinct. You know, these are just not the things that a lot of people are focused upon. People are stuck in survival, or they're stuck in the vacuum of capitalism. They're stuck in the vacuum of just their own, like, narcissisms and their own like surface level ambitions. People not really prioritizing like the who they are. They're just prioritizing the what they can accumulate, you know? And my life is still largely fixated upon the who. I'm still somebody who gets shocked when like I'm shocked that people are not interested in who they are. I'm shocked. It still blows my head because I can't get past this conviction. I've had this conviction my whole life that who I am is important. who I am as a person is the real gunk of life, that who I'm going to bed as, who I'm waking up as. And to like be coaxing a long life with droves of people who don't care about who they are. They just care about who other people think they are. And they only care about what they can get their hands on in life. And they only care about... That's so fucking foreign to me. It's so foreign to me. And, you know, like, right now, I have some people who are trying to make up with me. There are some makeup sessions that are attempting to be had. And my issues with the makeup sessions are a few things. For one, the people that are attempting to make up with me did really bad things. And not even bad things as in, like, you know, eons ago. But bad things as in, like, girl, just 24 hours ago. Just like last year ago. Just like a few months ago. And I'm all for people being different. And people repenting. And people becoming brand new. But the issue with the people who are trying to make up with me is that they actually aren't different people. And they don't want to publicly correct the things that they did publicly. And I don't believe in resolving public matters privately. If all hell broke loose publicly, then all heaven is going to have to break loose publicly as well. And it's not enough to just we wake up one day and we're okay because you just ready to be okay and I'm ready to be okay. No, bitch. I also am protecting my peace. And so it also matters to me who the fuck is occupying my energy and who the fuck gets my energy and who the fuck gets connected to me. Like just like who I am is important to me, who the fuck you are is significant as well. Especially, you know, if we're talking about you being in my life. Now, you don't have to change for the better. And you don't gotta atone for anything publicly if the plan is for you to just stay over there and me stay over here. But the problem with wanting to make up and wanting there to be some forward moving that involves the both of us together is, once again, people don't want to correct the shit that they're going to need to, that they're going to have to fucking correct if they want access to any degree of me. And these people also haven't changed. And for me, my attitude is I'm not going to – speak truth to power and be a check and balance system for the fuck shit in the world. And then not put that fuck shit through the proper filters if that fuck shit is talking about coming back into alignment with myself. Because I feel like to disregard the repentance of it all, to disregard, you know, the who this these people are, is to also kind of shit on my own mission. So I can't just make up. I can't, because I was on a mission and it was a justified mission. And one of my missions as an Avenger is to protect the innocent. And a lot of people trusted in me. And they relied on me. And I showed up for them. And I'm not going to let them down. Or slap them in the face or gaslight them by aligning with their abuser when that abuse was the truth. And if that, and if those people are not going to vindicate the people that they've hurt and vindicate my mission by addressing and being able to own up to the fuckery of it all, then no. You know, you just got to keep going on about your way, because this also ain't just about me. And what I'm doing ain't just about me. And I got to like read the room, because everybody is looking. And so shit got to be done properly. So right now we're at a standstill. And I'm okay with that standstill. Because, you know, in this age, you can't really come for anybody's neck or speak, you know, you can't speak the facts and the truth without even the wrong people retaliating. Like, we live in an era where the bad guys will attack you for holding their bad behavior accountable. And it's like, yeah, boo, like, ain't gonna be no making up, bitch, like, because you know what you did. Y'all know what y'all did. And we not about to have no sisterhood and have no brotherhood and be on no kiki nothing, because in holding your whack ass accountable, you try to then spin the block and pull a reverse fucking Uno to deflect off yourself, instead of just taking the fucking opportunity to really do some self-correction. But instead, you decided to defend yourself against what the fuck was actually true and cause harm to those who you fucked over, and those who were protecting those who you fucked over. And what the fuck it looked like with us just showing up in a space together in good energy. And that posture and that crime and the blood from those crimes have not been atoned for. At this point, I just love myself too much and take my own work seriously enough to maintain the continuity. I'm okay with the evil villains of Gotham converting into the heroes of the city. As long as, once again, that's under the guise of actual change and transformation, but you still just want to pretend to be a good guy, or you want to just have access to me and be on your bald-headed ho shit. No. Mm-mm. I'm not working this hard, and I have personally sacrificed too much. And once again, I've given too much of my energy and too much of my time to just let. Because here's the thing for me. I can't deal with a pseudo positive outcome. As you guys have already learned through this commentary, girl, it's like everything needs to be genuine and everything needs to be on theme. Everything needs to be on brand for me. I'm not a go along to get along ass type of a bitch. I actually stand for something, which is why I don't just fall for any fucking thing. I'm an actual truth seeker, and I believe in who I am, and I believe in what I do in all facets of the word. What I do as a commentator, what I do as a man, what I do as a leader, like, I take all of that seriously. And that's what I'm leaving behind when I'm going on to the next experience. And I just can't imagine just, because the part of me that's been taught to be the go along to get along type of a bitch is the part of me that's like, oh, girl, I'm the only bitch being serious. Let me just go along to get along so that I cannot, you know, just to go along to get along. But I'm just like, no, bitch, no, I'm sorry. I'm going to have to stick to my guns. I'm going to have to stick to my guns, because if it was me, I would need somebody to maintain the quality of the movement, which once again draws me back to myself. Like, I realize it's up to me to be a tangible truth and to be a tangible, practical representation of what I believe in the world. And nobody's going to take it upon themselves to be that for me. Nobody's going to take it upon themselves to be the type of person or the type of representation we hear talking about Lil Nas X or the type of whatever. Like, that's all up to me. It's up to me to be that truth. It's up to me to be that person. So I'm not compromising. And I will take the L's and take whatever the consequences are of not settling for a mediocre positive outcome or not settling for a false sense of security or not falling for a pseudo light and love ending. Why should I have had to be as for real only to have to settle for something so not for real? That literally makes no sense to me. Like, the math is not motherfucking math. So it's shit right now that's pending. It's shit right now that's on the back burner. If you guys see me make up with anybody, I have enough self-respect to make sure that that is going to be done in the way that it needs to be done. And you guys will see everything play out how it needs to play out. And what I can tell you guys is not going to happen is I'm not going back to unchanged people. I don't care if those unchanged people still love me. I don't care if those unchanged people still have a value for me. I don't care about none of that. If they have not changed for the better, I don't care about what they want. There will not be a us without the change that needs to accommodate that as well. One of my baby mamas. Hold on, somebody. Thank you, Courtney, for the nasty piece of Cash App. Thank you, baby mama. Thank you. Oh, appreciate the serious truth sayer in you. Thank you. Hey, G baby. You know, because y'all, I've been through some shit. And I have I have really had to do not only my motherfucking work, bitch. I have had to show up. I've had to show up for people. In real ways, in sacrificial ways, in ways that really costed me. And I take pride in that. I love it for me. And it's not enough for a bitch to just think they can just pull up on me and give me a little 1-2-1-2 and think that it's all good, because it ain't, bitch. It's not. You're gonna have to come a lot harder than just that, because once again, some real shit went down and you just don't get to earn this back. You don't get to receive this back. You don't get to inherit this back. You don't get to come back to eating, you know, on a WIC voucher. That's what you don't get to do. You don't get to come back to eating on a buddy pass. You just don't. So if a bitch ain't actually transformed and transmuted and became and risen again, fuck your pseudo makeup. That benefits you and I how exactly? It doesn't. Good morning, Dr. Soapy and Lynn and Sherry. Hi, y'all. So I'm standing on business, girl. 2024 standing on business, and I realized that it's also up to me to be a fence, bitch. A Jesus ain't gonna be a fence. it's up to me to be a fence, you know. That I got to guard this kingdom thoroughly, and I got to guard it righteously. I got to guard my heart and my mind. And I got to guard my soul, and I got to guard my mission, and, you know, that this is the hill, you know, that this hill is mine. These assignments are mine. And it's okay if other people want to play with their shit. It's okay if other people want to be flimsy with their shit. It's okay if other people want to whatever, like, whatever setting they got the arcade machine on, it's theirs. But I gotta fuck with mine the way that mine is to be fucked with, you know? And I've been down this road of just being so casual and being so casual and being so passive and being so casual and, you know, just letting my empathic shit just being so communal and, girl, all that shit costed me hell. All that communal shit, make up with everybody, be just so friendly. No, bitch, I'm standing on business, bitch. I'm here to stand on business. I came to stand on business. I don't want to look like my fucking enemies. That's why I can't even fight these hoes the way that they fight, bitch. You know, we don't dox. We don't do any of that shit over here. Like, I don't even employ the same energy and the same weapons. Can and could, because it ain't no authority governing me. This is all self-governance. This is all self-afflicted virtue. You know, I'm not in that space. I can't just be with anybody. I can't just sit with just anybody. I can't just work with just anybody. Like, I'm just in that place where, you know, in the words of Erykah Badu, who I'm going to drag later. You know, this is my art and I'm sensitive about my shit. And I finally just accept that that's who I am, and I'm happy and I'm content and I'm at peace with being a bitch who takes his shit seriously. And that's why I had to clip so many people. You guys have seen me clipping, separating myself. And it's the way that it's going to continue to be, because honestly, I would rather do bad all by myself. And I actually don't do bad at all. You know, like I'm not insecure enough to just hold on to anything. I'm not insecure enough to just hold on. Like, I'm not insecure. I don't have those voids, you know, and I'm strong enough to deal with a void without filling it in artificially, without artificially flavoring shit. You know, I'm okay with that. So I don't know how some of these people who are trying to have conversations with me and trying to figure out how we can whatever, because I've already told them, like, you're going to have to come with it publicly. You're going to have to atone publicly, because that's where the transgressions and the offenses took place. And for two, it's not enough that you just want to be good and you just want things to be fluff between us, bitch. If you still a raggedy, decrepit, demonic, broken, frail, weirdo, then stay the fuck away from me, bitch, because I also don't need your isolated ass positivity either. Because I'm not co-signing no fuck shit. When you flip out again and you turn into a Hurricane Katrina again and you want to be a tsunami again, or when all your bullshit, you know, hits the fan again, bitch, like, I'm going to need no relations and dealings. Don't want none of the residual impact. Don't want none of the residual faults. Don't want none of that, bitch. Like, you're going to have to give what I give in vibration. Like, that's it. That's all. So we'll see how that goes. And once again, if I make up with any of them hoes, ain't going to be no private anything. Y'all gonna see a bitch brought right to the town square, and y'all gonna see it all hammered out before the townspeople. You know, not only on the strength of being able to take accountability, but also on the strength of being a different type of a motherfucker. Because I'm also clear about the fact that, because when I look at some of the people that are famous right now, and I look at some of the people that have power right now, I also realize, like, we are indirectly also liberating all the wrong folk. And I don't also want to contribute to liberating the wrong people. I don't want to contribute indirectly, unconsciously, in any kind of way to emotionally stupid ass people, materially driven, selfish ass, narcissistic ass people, occupying power and getting a hold of power and keeping that dysfunction and that divisiveness amongst the collective pervasive. You know, that I have to once again come into full awareness about my own power and how I contribute to the larger pool and how I contribute to the larger system, you know, which is with my contribution, what that contribution is. So I don't want to see any more fucked up ass people with power. I don't want to see no more fucked up ass people with influence. I don't want to see no more fucked up ass motherfucking. I'm sick of it. I'm over it. And I ain't got nothing to do with other people pedestalizing all the wrong people. The only thing I can do is make sure that I don't contribute to the pedestalization and the liberation of all the wrong motherfuckers. So that's that. What's going on, Brains Tickle? CTV made me change my profile picture to my war face. What's going on, Sharon? Hey, y'all, what's going on? Brandy on the rocks. With that being said, let's move into some sugar baby teas. So we're going to go into a completely different left situation, girl, okay? This sugar baby lifestyle is very fascinating to me. You guys know that I think in my last live stream, I had announced, well, you guys know I got a lot of shit going on. The end of last year, 2023, I ended up at a lot of tables, and a lot of interviews. And so I'm not going to say my brand is changing, but it is growing and expounding. And I'm got my hands into some other things outside of just social media. In terms of a little coffee table book that I'm so excited to be completing and to be publishing. You guys know that there's been some reality TV stuff that I have been working out and opportunities that have been presented to me. You guys know that me and Claudia Jordan also are working on some things together that also involve some other YouTubers. So there's like a lot of things that are going on in the backdrop and a lot of things that are just in the works and a lot of things that personally I just want to accomplish and make sure that I fulfill because it's a part of my assignment as well. And because I'm a very like assignment driven individual, I don't have time, bitch, for this white man system at all. Like, I don't got none of the time for it. Like, I need to get bitch straight to the business. Okay? I ain't got time to be dilly-dabbling and suffering and the struggle of it all, girl. And it's so funny to be in this era where it is a lot easier to gain access to wealth or to gain access to certain things just off of some very simple attributes like beauty. That like there's literally a equity on beauty, hence some of the beauty brands that I'm also going to be collaborating with who are interested in utilizing my aesthetics and having me be a part of their brand and vice versa. And it has been a very interesting ride as a sugar baby, okay? I Now, when I say sugar baby, there are definitely various tier groups to being a sugar baby. Okay, you have sugar babies who do like non-sexual sugar baby work, okay? And then you got sugar babies who be like on the escort and shit. You know, all sugar babies are not made equal, bitch, okay? But I think what I'm understanding, because I have homegirls and homeboys who are a part of the sugar baby culture and the sugar baby world, and the principle at work is using what you got to get what the fuck you want. And I did not know that there are people in this world who look for convenience and who will pay you to accommodate them. That is a very like interesting world. Like, and people are willing to pay you for what is considered to be mundane interactions. You got sugar daddies and sugar mamas that you only text, that you only, you know, are on FaceTime with, that you may even see in person, and they are willing to monetize your time and just monetize your company. They're willing to monetize flirtiness and flirtatiousness and the amounts of guap that people are willing to spend just for your time or just to play into a fantasy. It has been very extreme to actually, you know, like to hear about these things is one thing, but then to like be brought into the culture itself has been very eye-opening. It has taught me a lot about the wealthy. It's taught me a lot about the lifestyles of the wealthy, and how time is something that a lot of wealthy people are, that they don't have a lot of, which is why they have a kind of like a drive-through attitude, like a, you know, because what they really are paying for, whether it's your time, it's your friendship, it's your whatever it is, they're paying for convenience. They're paying to have you right there, right here, at this time, in this way, emotionally, mentally, physically, et cetera, whatever way, whatever the arrangements are. Because once again, various tier groups, girl, to the sugar baby shit, okay? I got friends who, once again, only have a emotional obligation to their sugar babies and sugar mamas. I got a homeboy who got a really good thing going with a very wealthy female CEO, and she's pretty much paying him to have a emotional affair. Like, he's her emotional boyfriend. They have never had sex. They've never even shared a kiss. But they have created this fantasy of a relationship through emotionality. So he shows up and he talks to her through text, through talk, through FaceTime, and when they also spend time together, like a actual lover does, without actually having to be an actual lover. And she pays him to fill this emotional void in her life. Same thing with like my homegirls. A lot of them are just being paid to be pretty on a high profile nigga's arm, or they're being paid by like older wealthy men to also do the same thing, to take up a space emotionally. Which is also interesting to me, because what I've learned about a lot of successful people is that they experience a lot of loneliness. And they get to a point where they transcend needing it to be genuine. They are okay even with the performative thing as long as they can still get the thing. You know, it doesn't even matter to them anymore if it's genuine, if it's real, especially if it's emotional based anyway. You know, like, if you're willing to be a part of that fantasy, then it's essentially real to them. And just being able to be, like, to just have these sugar daddies and sugar mamas, just them just knowing that they have something in their life that looks, that walks like a duck, talk like a duck, quack like a duck. These people pay stupid, dumb, ratchet ass monies to just have that to look forward to in their day, in their week, in their month. You know, like, just to have somebody artificially loving on them, you know, to just hear that I love you, to just see that I love you in a text form, to just human beings are just very interesting to me. I'm learning a lot about human psychology. I'm learning a lot about what humans really need, and that beyond the glitz and the glam and the attainment of wealth and money and means and power and all of this shit, at the end of the day, that everybody, I don't give a damn on what economic level they exist in, are just human, and they want what the fuck any other warm-blooded thing wants in this world, which is a space where they can be their authentic selves and love for who they actually are. To have some sense of, like, intimacy mentally, emotionally, spiritually, or physically in their lives. To have that outlet. And that people, for whatever reason, whether they work a lot, they travel a lot, they're the demands of their life don't allow them to really develop that. Like, people don't really care, once again, about the real thing. That desperation to have that love and to have and to not be lonely is something that a lot of the wealthy and powerful are so desperate for that they're willing to pay you to pretend to care about them and to love them. So that old adage of, like, money can't buy love, right? It can't buy the real love. It can buy you a great imitation of it. So looking at all these non-sexual job occupations and the level of economic advantage in that is very ideal, especially for bitches like all my bad bitches and all of my niggas who got other shit to do. Like, the fact that you can make a standard salary just by going on a few dates a year and maintaining a consistent verbal and textual rapport with one person, and you can make a standard salary just having an emotional affair. Pretty much it's an acting gig. Being a fucking actor is buck wild to me. It's buck wild. And a lot of my homeboys and homegirls who are sugar babies and have sugar mamas and sugar daddies, like, they're able to take this sugar baby ass money and pour it into their businesses, like into their actual dreams, like pay for school, like, you know, paying their way through college. Like they're doing like real shit with the money that they're making. And I'm not even like mad at it, because I'm just like, yo, working front desk as a administrative assistant, you know, at a fucking dentist office, 5 days a fucking week, 8 hours a goddamn day, and you can make that fucking salary as a sugar baby, like getting flued the fuck out, like getting paid to maintain your aesthetics. You're pretty much living the lifestyle of a goddamn heir. I can't be mad at that, because for what? For why would you be behind the desk dealing with people, dealing with a stupid ass boss, overworked, underpaid, and having to give up all of your weekly, monthly, daily fucking time to a career and a job you're not even pressed about, just for the sake of like making ends meet, when you can like actually live well and do a lot fucking less and get a lot fucking more? Like the fuck? Bitch, I ain't mad, girl. I'm just not motherfucking mad about it, because as long as everything is consensual, I, like, why the fuck would you put any more work into this system than what you have to? If there are ways for you to get out of this system without compromising who you are, without compromising your morals and your values, like, for the sugar babies who giving up the pussy and the bussy and the ass, like, even for a lot of them, like, one of my homegirls, I was just talking to her the other day, and she was like, bitch, she is fucking one of her sugar daddies, but the gag is she's fucking a sugar daddy she would have been fucking for free anyway, because she's actually attracted to him. And if he's just gonna add the extra punch by paying her for what she was already and would have been willing to do for free, then bitch, you got a good thing going. I'm taking you to my sanctuary as I have to get ready. I'm listening. Okay, Sherry. St. Marquis says, exactly. The only haters are the dusty visual red pill incels. People will pay for companionship no different than having a home health aid. But you know what, brains? That's why they call your ass brain tickles, okay? People will pay you for companionship no different than having a home health aide. What's the difference, baby? Okay. Working as a personal assistant, as a home health aide. You know, I mean, a chauffeur, a Lyft driver. I mean, you're in the business of customer service. Okay. And just like the world of customer service is very diverse. Like, you got, like, I got homegirls who, and homeboys who cam models, you know, like all of their clients are online based and digital based. You know, they have successful OnlyFans, successful online brands selling sensuality, They ain't never got to suck on nothing, fuck on nothing, ride on nothing, touch on nothing. They are able to show what they want to show, emphasize what they want to emphasize. They're completely in the creative lane to customize what they give and what they're comfortable with. And that customization exists in the sugar baby culture as well. Because I think that the misconception about sugar babies is that they're fucking and that they are essentially high paid ass escorts. And that couldn't be the furthest thing from the truth. Oh, that's you, BT. Okay. That's you, girl. I'm like, what? I forgot you said you changed your name. Hey, boo. What's going on? Color me Oakland. Shout out to Oakland. Shout out to my baby mother, FB, for the Disney Music Child Award. Shit. Thank you, baby mama. Hey, FB. So, you know, like, and BTCOS, a brains herself, she's in that world. And I have a lot of respect for that whole fucking lane of things. So it's just been interesting to me. I know some of the clientele of some of my friends, and I've been able to see how it works from inside out. Right now I'm doing some test runs myself, where I have some really interesting individuals who want to monetize me speaking to them, talking to them, making myself verbally available to them. And man, I just can't tell you how the internet done changed the motherfucking game, baby. Technology done changed the whole motherfucking game, bitch. And, you know, my attitude has always been work smarter, bitch, not harder. And I love this. I love this for all of us. I love that there's the space where you can capitalize in this non-idealistic world, right? Because we are talking about a world that's broken, a world that's capitalistic, a world that's imperfect. But when these like kind of bonus lanes open up that kind of allow us to kind of get creative and make our grand exits out of the matrix in order to really do the things that we're really called to, I really feel like the sugar baby lane is able to go to the next level because of technology. It allows people to still have a safe distance and to feel comfortable, and to control the access that a person or persons have to them, while also being able to stay close to what they really believe in, which allows them, once again, to not be in positions where they have to compromise or do anything they don't want to do, while also getting paid than what, you know, corporate America at this point is really paying any one person. You guys like being like, oh, so many people are trying to be an influencer. So many people are trying to like, you know, everybody want to OnlyFans. The reason why is because people are interested in working smarter and not fucking harder. And if you can sell your fucking feet on OF a week and make 30 grand a month, make 15 grand in a week and a half. Like, if you can be a sugar baby and not have to fucking suck on nobody, and to just be pretty and attractive, and to just be a body, and to just be a personality. Like, it's just like, why would people in a capitalistic system where they got fucking bills and want to be able to pay those bills without having to break a sweat? Idealistically, like, why would people not be taking these fucking avenues? I think that people should do whatever they're comfortable with, as long as it's legal and as long as it's consenting. And for me, my attitude is like, it's not really about what you do. It's just about how you do what you do. You know, if you actually find, because look, I got just as many people in my life who complain to me every day about their fucking corporate ass lives. They're miserable. They fucking feel dead on the inside. They feel like fucking slaves on a goddamn plantation. And despite them having a so-called respectable career, a respectable employment, they're asking the people who have unconventional careers for financial aid, to borrow money, girl. I'm a whole fucking influencer and a whole fucking YouTuber. And my friends who are in corporate spaces have to ask me for loans, have to ask me to borrow money. And they're the ones in the conventional workplace world. Buckety wild. And to be honest, I couldn't imagine being them. I haven't been in corporate America in like over a fucking decade, if not longer. I couldn't imagine sitting in a fucking cubicle dealing with customers, or I just couldn't imagine being honestly in any situation that it's not a creative one, because that's just not what I was created to do, you know? And I walk away from every conversation with my working class friends, not my working class friends, but my corporate America friends, like just always feeling so bad for them. Like, they're so confused. They don't even know who the fuck they are anymore. They've had to work in this conventional system for so long that they haven't even had time to even cultivate like what the fuck it is that they really want to do, like, with their lives. Like, the way that this oppressive ass capitalistic system got people in a chokehold, people haven't even been able to like have the time in their life to even cultivate a vision and to get in touch with their passions, to get in touch with, you know, what they've been created to fucking do. So many people want to do OF and want to be an influencer or want to be a sugar baby. I want to do any fucking thing but what they're doing in corporate America, because people want actual time with their family. They want to see the world. They want to be a fucking human being. Like, they want to actually be a part of life, not just an observer of life. They want to be a part of that shit. And I think the landscape is changing. And I even look at, like, Megan Thee Stallion out here living her dreams. You know, she started off as a college student. Then she got discovered. And then she also maintained, like, getting her education, finishing her degree. You know, just making sure that she was both-handed, baby. Okay, which I think was a fucking genius. You know, like, just like I got friends who on their Megan Thee Stallion shit, they are doing OF and or they are non-sexual sugar babies, but then they're using like that money that they're making from their clients to fund their way through school, like just like the strippers do. You know, the strippers ain't just a bunch of fucking hoes hitting the pole popping pussy. Like, these are also people who are entrepreneurs. They have a work smarter, not harder attitude. And they're thinking about the most practical way to get to the big dollars and then have a plan for those big dollars and are pouring those big dollars back into whatever careers they actually want for themselves. Whether that's a musical career, whether that's a beauty shop, rather that whatever the fuck it is, you know? And it's become a whole lifestyle. Like, I think that there's a whole, like, sugar baby fucking, like, sector on fucking YouTube of, like, badass fucking bitches who just keep themselves up, work out, vegan, plant-based, you know? They stay in the gym, they're fit because their equity is in their health and it's in their beauty, and they literally just have their lifestyles completely afforded to them just because of what they look like and or what they are offering to their clientele, and are not even having to, once again, even pop no pussy in order to do that. And I love it. I love it for them. I love it for us. So I say all that to say, girl, times are changing. And don't be afraid, girl. You know, it's just, you guys heard the old saying that, like, the person who was drowning kept asking spirit to, like, come rescue them, come rescue them, come rescue them. And so spirit sent them a boat. They was like, no, sent them a helicopter, no, sent them, you know, sent them help for every generation. No, because they needed spirit to come and to literally pull them and rescue them up, girl. And then they end up drowning, girl. Okay, girl, where a lot of these things that are being introduced into the culture, girl, these are the boats and the helicopters coming to the motherfucking aid, bitch. And I would just encourage folk to get real open-minded, because this system, it don't give a fuck about you. And if you allow it to take away the quality of your life, if you allow it to take you away from your children, take you away from your dreams, take you away from yourself, take you away from whatever the fuck, it will. Because it's all about self. The system is all about self. So never be afraid to think about what's best for you. Never be afraid to think about what's in your best interest. Never be afraid to use your mind to get what the fuck you want. And to understand that, yes, it's on you. The system is not rewarding it's just not rewarding those who are very crispy. Those who are very tight. You know, it's not rewarding, girl. Like, we're going to have to remix and turn this system out and use it to our advantage. And there are ways to do that without it costing you prison time, and also without it costing you your soul. It's just more so about you just being educated about all your options and being aware of all of your fucking options. Now, I got to get up out of here, y'all, because I got shit to do and I wasn't supposed to be here for 2 hours. But I want to touch on this last point, which is school. So speaking of going back to school and all of that shit, I've been exploring my options because I want to get into public relations. And you can get into this field by way of degrees and certifications, but it's really also like going into the profession of management, which you can just do through acquiring experience and shadowing, you know, individuals and just picking up experience and putting time in the actual business. So I've been contemplating on whether I want to go to school or rather I just want to which I think I'm going to go to school for communications and or go to school for journalism or business management. So it'll either be for communications or business management or journalism. And I'm thinking it'll probably be between the business management and the journalism, since both of those go hand in hand with what I already do as a influencer and as a commentator. So that's just something I want to have in the bag. And it is something that I'm super passionate about. And it's something that I already have a lot of experience in. So I'm just thinking about going ahead and sinking my teeth into that and adding that to my resume and my repertoire as a person. So we'll see. And last but not least, Miss Cannabis. My friend is in Sweden right now because he's on a spiritual assignment. Him and another one of our associates got called out to pretty much exercise a property out in Sweden by this family who's being haunted by these very diabolical forces. And they have already had priests. They've had shamans. They've had all type of damn spiritualists come out, and to no avail has this activity ceased. So my American friends were called to be flew out to Sweden, all paid expense trip to exercise the fuck out of this land. And that's already been a fascinating journey. But upon my friend who's on assignment, he was able to pick up some edibles because the associate, our mutual associate, is like a cannabis specialist. And he has a very well-known cannabis company out in Colorado. And he gifted my friend some edibles. Now, you guys know I had a spiritual experience on edibles back in 2022. And everything that I've been like dealing with when it came to my shadow work over the past 6 weeks and just coping with this era that we're living in and this technological era, da 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 da. I am interested in another experience. So I'm going to be having another edible experience, which will be my second one, when he returns. And that's something that will probably happen in the month of April, because what we want to do this time around, since my first experience was so fucking hyper spiritual and supernatural, is we're going to document it. And he's going to kind of play a scientist, the role of a scientist, and I'm going to play the role of the participant and of the target, because he's also studying to be a hypnotherapist. So we're just going to kind of kill a lot of birds with one stone. And I'm actually looking forward to this experience now that I know kind of what to expect, in a sense, even though you really can't expect anything when it comes to any type of psychedelic, because you just don't know what type of experience you're really going to have. It really just comes down to spirit and comes down to your damn soul, what your experience is going to be. But right now, my expectation is that I will have another trip home, and I need another return trip home. I'm a little bit homesick. I need another like cosmic hug. I need another like multiverse hug. I need like just, I need a ego obliterating experience. And I just need that raw synergy from creation, you know, from the creator, creators. I'm like, I just need that cosmic love again. It was such a incredible experience that I had, and it lasted me for so long. Like, I'm still like, it like, what, we're going on like a little over a year now since my last experience. Wait, yep, actually a year and like 3 months. So that's how powerful that experience was for me. And now that I know how much love is available in the universe by way of these plants and these oils, it really is, once again, another avenue to obtain the divine without having to work day and night for the Kundalini and work day and night to tarry for the damn Holy Spirit and all this, you know, old school shit we used to have to do to like synchronize the left and right hemispheres of the damn brain. So these edible experiences, probably once a year, because I can't imagine doing them multiple times a year, because for me, they have too much of a dramatic experience for me to need something like that every day or every week or every month. But I think that that's going to be one of the self-care practices I'm going to have to help me to navigate the future of the world and to navigate this era that I'm not enjoying, is if I have to endure this era and I have to put up with like this shallowness from the culture and this kind of emptiness that kind of exists within humanity, that I at least need to be able to go fucking home every now and again and just get some metaphorically old school cooking and all of that, you know, because I just can't deal in this fake ass system. Like, I just can't. I would not be able to just exist in this fake ass system without equally needing the Father, Son, and the Holy Daughter. So I plan on staying real prayed the fuck up going forward, deepening all of my spiritual practices, my meditations, working out, eating clean, just helping my mind, helping my body, helping everything in me, because I think that we haven't even scratched the surface in terms of what this era is all going to come with, and this data around technology and what it's already doing to the human psyche is really destructive, and it's really sad. And we only plan on being more innovative when it comes to technology and social media. So it means that a lot of the negative side effects of technology and social media are only going to get worse. And self-care is just going to be of utmost importance. So edibles once a year for me, because bitch, I can't. Earth is ghetto as fuck. Humanity is ghetto as fuck. Like this, I feel like we're living in a collective ass projects. And I just feel like I'm waking up metaphorically to gunfire every fucking day. Like whether it's gunfire in the political landscape, in the entertainment landscape, it's just gunfire, girl, and it's just ain't enough. It ain't enough love. It's not enough intimacy. It's not enough, like, equally balancing that shit. And I'm just going to have to supplement by, once again, just staying very close to me and just staying plugged in to that infinite well that Christ spoke to that lonely ass woman about, you know, who was trying to find all of her substance through men and relationships. And so navigating the matrix while also maintaining your spiritual integrity and maintaining your spiritual well-being, that balancing act is our responsibility. And I just want to encourage you guys to, you know, any opportunity that you get to take it to make things easier on yourself in this matrix, do so. And also maintain all of your spiritual connectedness. We're living in some very interesting, chaotic times. So just love on yourself and try not to let this raggedy tide ass weird ass system change you for the worse. Don't let other people's judgments and bullshit thinking take away from your willingness to once again make things easier for yourself. Nobody's going to care more about you than you. And allow self preservation to exist in your life. Not entirely, but definitely prioritize self preservation. Your mental health and your spiritual health and your overall well-being, it is significant, y'all. And I think that we are headed towards some really dark times. I don't think people will really love each other like that. I don't think intimacy is that available. And when I say intimacy, I'm not talking about like sexual intimacy. I'm just talking about like intimacy as an intimacy. Like, I just think that deep connections and meaningful engagements and meaningful interactions, I think that those things are going to become even more rare. So you're going to have to find a way to be able to stand up against that. And I don't know any other thing to encourage you guys to do but to love on yourself and to go into spirit and to prioritize that meditation, because it is wellness in those sessions. So, light and love, in tune like an empath, detached like a psychopath, king to, yes, gentle as a dove, wise as a serpent. That's how I see it. That's it. It's that balancing act. It's that balancing act. It's that balancing act, CK. AK93, hey boo, I feel the same way, conscious. Whitney B says, I've been going back and forth with smoking and not smoking. You know, everything is about balance. You know, you don't ever want to be codependent upon anything. But, you know, the old saying ultimately is like, if it ain't broke, don't fucking fix it. If you find things that work for you, that help you with your well-being, that help you with your self-esteem, that help you with your sense of peace and happiness, definitely commit to those things. And just advocate for yourself. You know, just advocate for yourself and know that how you feel and the condition of your feelings and your experiences here are important. And once again, different things work for different people. So don't necessarily compare yourself to other people. Just explore. Always do your research. Always keep your eye out, you know, on the marketplace, you know, to just see what's all out there floating about. And don't be afraid to explore different ways of caring for yourself and making life easier for yourself. Nobody's coming back for us. We have been given the tools to save ourselves. So in whatever way you need to self-actualize the inner savior, then do that. And once again, you can be in the world and not of the world. You know, so stay true to yourself. Try to enjoy yourself. Be yourself. Anything that's compromising who you are, walk away from it. Get away from it. Find your way away from it. And don't let this world turn you into everything that you hate about it. You know, anything that's causing that, anything that's corrupting you, then, you know, it's time to make some adjustment. So I gotta go. I got shit to do. I love you guys. I just wanted to come and chit chat with you all. And I'll see you guys later. Bye.